Hello, my dear students. We are studying labor law paper first, which is applicable for BA LLB as well as BB LLB program. It's a 5-year program. And it is video lecture number 22. And today, under Industrial Dispute Act 1947, we'll study about work committees, the works committee under section 3, and the conciliation machinery given under section 4 and 5 under ID, Industrial Dispute Act 1947. So when we talk about the works committees given under section 3, in the case of any industrial establishment in which 100 or more workmen are employed or have been employed on any day in the preceding 12 months, the appropriate government may, by general or special order, require the employer to constitute in the prescribed manner a works committee consisting of representatives of employers and workmen engaged in the establishment, so however that the number of representatives of workmen on the committee shall not be less than the number of representatives of the employer. So meaning thereby is that for the establishment where 100 or more workmen are employed or have been employed on any day in the preceding 12 months, then appropriate government may, by general or special order, require the employer to constitute in the prescribed manner a works committee. And in this works committee, the representatives of the employers and the workmen would be in equal numbers, or the representative of the workmen on the committee shall not be less than the number of the representatives of the employer. So we try to balance this committee. The representatives of the workmen shall be chosen in the prescribed manner from among the workmen engaged in the establishment and in consultation with their trade union. So the workers, those who are going to represent the works committee, these workmen should be engaged in the establishment and in consultation with their trade union office bearers, we should just take these workmen as a representative for the works committees. If any registered, in case there is any registered trade union, then we can just ask them that to whom you would you like to nominate, or who will be representing. And it shall be the duty of the works committee to promote measures for securing and preserving amity and good relations between the employer and workmen, and to that end to comment upon matters of their common interest or concern, and endeavor to compose any material difference of opinion in respect of such matters. So it is the duty of the works committees to promote measures for securing and preserving amity and good relations. See, the purpose of this works committee is to just secure and preserve the good relations between the employer and workman. And these works committee members should comment upon the matters of their common interest or concern, and endeavor to compose any material difference of opinion in respect of such matters. So they should sit together, and if there is any differences of opinion for any matter which is of the common interest for the employer also, for the employees also, then they should just comment on that, and they should sit and they should just resolve those differences in respect of such matters. So this is about the works committee we have in the industrial establishments. Now we talk about the conciliation machinery. As we all are aware, and my dear students, we have just gone through in the previous lecture that Industrial Dispute settlement machinery is available under the Industrial Dispute Act 1947, and we have the conciliation machinery to resolve those industrial dispute as a settlement machinery. Conciliation is a form of mediation actually, and mediation is the act of making active effort to bring two conflicting parties to compromise actually. So mediation, it's a form of mediation, and conciliation is a form of mediation, and mediation is the act of making active effort to bring two conflicting parties to compromise. And mediation, however, differs from conciliation. Though mediation is a form of mediation, but still it differs from the conciliation in that, whereas conciliator plays only a passive and indirect role. In conciliation, the conciliator plays only a passive and indirect role. And the scope of his function is provided under the law. The mediator takes active part. On the contrary, you will find that whenever there is a mediation, then mediator takes an active part, and the scope of his activities are not subject to any statutory provisions. While the conciliation is a statutory provision given under Section 4 of the ID Act 1947. So, though conciliation is a form of mediation, but still mediation differs from the conciliation, because conciliation is that where conciliator plays only a passive and indirect role, and the scope is of his function is provided under the law. But the mediator takes active part, and the scope of his activities are not subject to any statutory provisions. And conciliation is the practice by which the services of a neutral party are used in dispute as a means of helping the disputing parties to reduce the extent of their differences and to arrive at an amicable settlement of agreed solution. I repeat, my dear students, that conciliation is the practice by which the services of a neutral party are used in a dispute as a means of helping the disputing parties to reduce the extent of their differences and to arrive at an amicable settlement of agreed solution. And the Industrial Dispute Act 1947 provides for conciliation and can be utilized either by appointing conciliation officers. These conciliation officers may be permanently or for a limited period, depends. So the appropriate government has to decide this, whether they require the permanent conciliation officers or they require these conciliation officers for a limited period, or by constituting a board of conciliation. And sometimes government may feel that there is a need of the boards of conciliation also, that they can constitute that board of conciliation also. And this conciliation machinery can take a note of a dispute. This conciliation machinery can take a note of dispute or apprehend dispute either on its own or when approached by either part. So the conciliation machinery can take a note of dispute or apprehend dispute either on its own or when approached by either of the party, then this conciliation machinery will be active and would be trying to resolve the issue. And with a view to expediting conciliation proceedings, actually time limits have been prescribed. And 14 days in the case of a conciliation officers and 2 months in case of a board of conciliation. So if the matter is before the conciliation officer, then the time limit to resolve this issue is 14 days. And if the matter is before the board of conciliation, then the time limit is 2 months. And settlement arrived at in courts of conciliation is binding for such period as may be agreed between the parties for such period, that agreement which settlement arrived at in the courts of conciliation is binding or for a period of 6 months. So whatever they have agreed upon for that period or for a period of 6 months and with continue to be binding until revoked by either party. And it will be continuing till the movement means either of the party just revoke the matter. So if the settlement arrived at in the course of conciliation is binding for such period as may be agreed upon between the parties for a period of 6 months and with continue to be binding until revoked by either party. And the act also prohibits strike and lockout during the pendency of the conciliation proceedings. So once the conciliation proceeding is going on before a board and then there is a provision by the act on a strike and lockout and during the pendency of that conciliation proceedings before a board and for 7 days after the conclusion of such proceedings. And means during the pendency of the conciliation proceedings and once this conciliation proceeding is pending before the board and for 7 days after the conclusion of such proceedings, the either of the party cannot go for the strike. And if it is a case of employer management, then cannot go for the lockout. Now we talk about the conciliation officer given under section 4. The law provides for the appointment of the conciliation officer and the appointment of this conciliation officer would be by the government to conciliate between the parties to the industrial dispute and conciliation officer is given the powers of a civil court whereby he is authorized to call the witnesses. And he is authorized to call the witness, the parties on oath. It should be remembered, however, whereas civil court cannot go beyond interpreting laws, the conciliation officers can go behind the facts and can make judgment, which will be binding on the parties. So it should be remembered. That however, whereas civil court cannot go beyond interpreting the laws, the conciliation officer can go behind the facts and can make judgments which will be binding upon the parties. And on receiving information about a dispute, the conciliation officer should give formal intimation in writing to the parties concerned of his intention to commence conciliation proceedings. I repeat, my dear students, that once the conciliation officer receives information about a dispute, the conciliation officer should give formal intimation in writing to the parties concerned, which are involved in that dispute, and of his intention to commence conciliation proceedings. So, once the conciliation officer is receiving the information about the dispute, will give a formal intimation in writing to the parties involved in that, and will just show the intentions that he will commence the conciliation proceedings from a specified date and he should then start doing all such things as he thinks fit for the purpose of persuading the parties to come to fair and amicable settlement of disputes. So in that way, the moment conciliation officer receives the information about the dispute, then that conciliation means the conciliation officer should give formal intimation in writing to the parties concerned for his intention to commence conciliation proceedings from a specified date and he should then start doing all such things as he thinks fit for the purpose of persuading the parties to come to fair and amicable settlement of the dispute. And the conciliation officer is required to submit his report to the appropriate government along with the copy of the settlement arrived at in relation to the dispute or in case conciliation has failed, then he has to send a detailed report giving out the reasons for failure of conciliation. So once the conciliation officer is you know submitting his report to the appropriate government. So he would be submitting his report to the appropriate government along with the copy of the settlement arrived, means, and in relation to the dispute. And in case if the conciliation has failed, then he has to send a detailed report giving out the reasons for failure of the conciliation machinery, that why the parties could not resolve this issue and why this conciliation was failed. So giving these reasons will be mentioned in the report of the conciliation office. And the report in either case must be submitted within 14 days of the commencement of conciliation proceedings or earlier. So within 14 days of the commencement of the conciliation proceedings, that report will be submitted. And but the time for submission of the report may be extended by an agreement in writing of all the parties to the dispute, subject to the approval of the conciliation officer. So the time given for the submission of the report is 14 days from the commencement of the conciliation office proceedings. But the time for the submission of the report may be extended by an agreement in writing of all the parties to the dispute, subject to the approval of the conciliation officer. And if an agreement is reached, and we call that agreement the memorandum of settlement, it remains binding for such period as is agreed upon by the parties. And if no such period is agreed upon, for a period of 6 months from the date on which the memorandum of settlement, means that agreement, or we call that memorandum of settlement, is signed by the parties to the dispute and continues to be binding on the parties after the expiry of period aforesaid until the expiry of 2 months from the date on which a notice in writing of an intention to terminate the settlement is given by one of the party or parties to the settlement. So in that way, this is what would be the binding effect of that memorandum of agreement. And so far the duties of a conciliation officers are concerned, the conduct, the conciliation officers' duties are to conduct proceedings of conciliation in a view to conclude the settlement between concerned parties amicably, and send the settlement report and a memorandum to the appropriate government. And send a conciliation officer is subject to one more duty, that is send a report to the government regarding what steps taken by him in case the process of settlement does not come to an end, and how the officer for conciliation cannot force for a settlement. He can only request and support the parties to conclude an agreement. And the Industrial Dispute Act restricts strikes, deadlocks during the ongoing proceedings of the conciliation that we have already discussed in the previous slide also. And then we talk about the, given under Section 5, the Board of Conciliations, in case of conciliation officers fails to resolve the difference between the parties, then the government has the discretion to appoint a board of conciliation, and the board is tripartite and ad hoc body, and it consists of chairman and 2 or 4 other members. And the chairman of that board of conciliation is to be an independent person, and other members are nominated in equal number by the parties to the dispute. Means we try to again go for a balance of equal representation from the workman side as well as from the employer side. And the conciliation proceedings before a board are similar to those that take place before the conciliation officer. And the government has yet another option of referring the dispute to the court of inquiry instead of the board of conciliation. And the machinery of the board is set in motion when a dispute is referred to it. In other words, the board does not hold the conciliation proceedings of its own accord. On the dispute being referred to the board, it is the duty of the board to do all things as it thinks fit for the purpose of inducing the parties to come and to a fair and amicable settlement. The board must submit its report to the government within 2 months of the date on which the dispute was referred to it. So it is the duty of the board that the board must submit its report to the government within 2 months of the date on which the dispute was referred to it. And this period can be further extended by the government by 2 months. So this is all about the Board of Conciliation, my dear students. And I hope today's lecture will just make you comprehend that how these conciliation officers given under Section 4 works, and how these Board of Conciliation given under Section 5 works. Thank you so much for your patience listening, and I believe this lecture will help you. Thank you so much. Have a nice day, and in our next lecture we will take up some new topic. Thank you so much. Have a nice time. Good day.